Hey everybody, this is Jared. Welcome back to the Auto Layout video tutorial series. In this video tutorial, you'll learn how to create constraints in code. If you're hardcore and you don't need no interface builder, this tutorial is for you. But even if your interface is primarily an interface builder, sometimes you need some code to add views based on some logic, and you'll want to know how to create constraints for those views as well. Constraints are calculated using this formula. Attribute 1 is equal to multiplier times attribute 2 plus a constant. NS layout constraint is the class you're dealing with when creating constraints in code. This formula translates very closely to the parameters in the NS layout constraint initializer. The first two parameters, view1 and attribute, together determine attribute1 from the formula. For view1, you'll just pass the view you want to create a constraint to. An attribute will use the NS layout attribute enum. You can look at the documentation for all the options on this enum, but they should be pretty familiar by now. Options like leading, trailing, center X, and for creating constraints to margins, leading margin, trailing margin, and so on. Related by uses the NS layout relation enum, and you can use this to create a less than or equal, or greater than or equal constraint. Similarly, view2 and attribute2 together determine attribute2 in the formula. If you're creating a constraint involving just one view, like an explicit height constraint, pass nil for view2 and use the not an attribute enum value for attribute2. Multiplier and constant are float values that correspond directly with those components in the formula. Notice there is no parameter in the initializer for the priority. The constraint will get created with a default priority of 1,000. If you want to set a different priority, set it after calling the initializer, but before activating the constraint. Once a constraint has been activated, you can only change the constant property. That's why it's called the constant property. I guess Apple engineers have a sarcastic streak. When you have your constraint configured, you must activate it, and the easiest way to do that is to set the active property to true. You can also call the ActivateConstraints class method on NSLayoutConstraint and pass an array of constraints to activate. There are a couple of important points to note when dealing with constraints in code. First, every view has a translates auto-resizing mask into constraints property that is set to true by default. If you're creating your own constraints on a view, you want this set to false. Interface Builder sets this to false for you on views it creates, but if you create a view in code and you're going to create constraints on it, you need to make sure you set this to false. If you forget, you will get errors in the debug console that your constraints are conflicting with the ones created by translates auto-resizing mask into constraints. Second, Interface Builder will create some views with different content hugging priorities than when you create those same views in code. For example, if you create a UI label in Interface Builder, it will have a content hugging priority of 251. But if you create it in code, it will have a content hugging priority of 250. Of course, you can change it from the default. It's just something to be aware of.
For this demo, this is the layout that we're going to build, but we're going to do it entirely in code. Let's get started. Just create a new project. This is an iOS application, single view application. I'll call it auto layout code. I'll just put that on my desktop. This time we're not going to use the storyboard. We're going to go right into code. You can create views in Interface Builder and then create the constraints for those views in code, but it's a little more complicated to do that. And so for simplicity, I'll just show you creating everything here. First, we'll create the three views for our interface. And because we always want to set translates auto-resizing mask into constraints to false, and we want to make sure we don't forget that, I always try to do that right away. As soon as I instantiate a view, I always set translates auto-resizing mask into constraints to false. Let's give ourselves a little room here. And we're going to set the text of this label to search. We'll just add it to the view. And now we want a text field. Again, we'll set translates auto-resizing mask into constraints to false right away. And we want this to be a rounded rect text field, so we'll set that border style and add it to the view. And finally, we want a button. Bet you can guess what I'm going to say next. We're going to set translate's auto resizing mask into constraints to false right away. We'll just configure the title and the color and a couple things. And we'll add it to the subview. Now we have all of our views created and added to the top level view, we need to add some constraints. Let's start with the label. We're going to create an NS layout constraint. We'll use this initializer. The first item is the view that we're creating a constraint on. It's the search label. Attribute is the leading edge. We want it to be equal to the view's leading margin. The multiplier is just 1.0, and in this case, the constant is 0. So now we have a new constraint between the search label and the view's leading margin, and we want to activate it. So we'll just call .active equals true here. There we have it, our first constraint in code. Let's add the baseline constraint between the label and the text field. The first item is the search label's baseline equal to the text field's baseline with a multiplier of 1 and a constant of 0, and we'll activate that as well. Those are the two constraints that we want to create on the label. Now let's create a few constraints on the text field. The order that you put the first item and the second item doesn't really matter a whole lot to the constraint that gets created. It only impacts really the constant, whether the constant is going to be positive or negative. In the case of these first two, our constant was 0, so it didn't really matter if we put the search label leading is equal to the view leading margin, or if we had put the view leading margin is equal to the search label leading, wouldn't really make any difference. So in this next case, I'm going to create a constraint between the text field trailing and the view's trailing margin, and I'll switch those just to show you that it doesn't really matter. Now you see here I have two choices, trailing and trailing margin. I'm creating a constraint between the trailing edge of the text field and the trailing margin of its superview. So I use the attribute trailing margin for the view and just.trailing for the text field. Then we want a top space constraint between the text field and the top layout guide. In this case, top layout guide is a property of the view controller that we're working in. So I could put self.topLayoutGuide or just top layout guide here. Now, when you're creating a constraint to the top layout guide and you're doing it in code, you need to create a constraint to the top layout guide's bottom attribute. The top layout guide's top is the very top of the view, and the bottom is what is below the status bar and any navigation elements, nav bar or something like that, at the top of the view. In this case, we want a constant of 20. So this is the first case where we have a constant that's not 0. If I had switched the first and second items here, the first item right now is text field top, and the second item is top layout guide bottom. If I switched those and put the top layout guide as the first element, then I would just have to make the constant a negative 20 to keep this constraint the same. It really just depends on your mental model, how you think of these constraints. Now let's create a constraint between the leading edge of the text field and the trailing edge of the label. And we want the leading edge of the text field to be 8 points away from the trailing edge of the label. Those are all the constraints we need on the text field. let's add some constraints to the button. First, we'll set its top equal to 8 points away from the text field bottom. Then we'll align the trailing edges of the button and the text field as well. Let's build and run this and see how our constraints work. There you have it. We created all three of these views in code. We created the constraints between them. Let's look at one thing real quick before we wrap up this demo. I'm going to add a breakpoint to viewed layout subviews. I want to show you how the priority of the constraints that are created automatically for you for the intrinsic content size of the label and the button are different in code than when you create them in an interface builder. We'll look a little bit more at debugging in a future tutorial, but let's just look at some of these constraints. Let me create some room for myself here. These are all of the constraints that are attached to the top level view, and there's a lot of them. We're not going to go through all of them in detail, but these aren't all the constraints. There's no content size constraints in here. And that's because constraints get attached to the first common view between the constraints. And in this case, it's not the top level view. Let's see if we can find them. Even though we don't have a reference to the views that we added because they were local in scope to viewDidLoad, I can find all of my subviews here. Okay, here's my label. It's subview number 2. If I print all the constraints that are attached to that subview, I can see I have in the horizontal direction and the vertical direction, I have some content size layout constraints, and the priority for hugging is 250 and compression resistance is 750. If I created this label in Interface Builder, it would get created with a default hugging priority of 251. So I just wanted to show you that that's different here.
Well, that's it for this video tutorial. As always, we'd like to leave you with a challenge. For this challenge, you'll build this layout in code. All the details are in the challenge document. I hope you enjoyed this tutorial. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.